Good afternoon, everyone. We'll start our fifth session, that is status of vocational education in the state. That's the tackle problems of dropouts and unemployment. We have our chairperson, Mr. Prakash Tingle, former Goa State Election Commissioner, educationist, legal expert. Our speaker, Blaise Costabel, MD GMI Zarak Molders Private Limited, J.R. Ribello, Chairperson, Goa Board of Secondary and High Secondary Education, Ms. Rose D'Souza, Assistant Director of Education. Thank you.
Yeah, we'll start this session of 5.
Status of vocational education in the state. Does it tackle problems of dropouts and unemployment? We start with a very good positive note. We have 2 dropouts from the speaker side. So we can allocate more time for the speakers who are there. Instead of 10 to 15 minutes, they can take around say minimum 15 to maximum 20. I will first call Professor Ribello. He has been the principal of the Fatah Aghna High Secondary and presently the chairman of the Goa Board. And they are also thinking, as per newspaper reports, of revitalizing vocational education, because we had just the silver jubilee of vocational education in Goa. I would invite him to present.
Chairperson of this session, Mr. Prabhakar Tingle, Mr. Kostabi, and Ms. Rose, and the audience, very good afternoon to all. At the outset, the topic is status of vocational education in Goa. The status will be given by the department representative, but I'll just focus on the first point, the second point, that is, does it tackle problems of dropouts and unemployment? About unemployment, I don't think I'll be the right person. Blaise is here, he could throw more light on that, but definitely about dropouts. When vocational education was started in Goa in the year 1988, it was started with the aim of creating a workforce and giving an alternative to the students. But it was started only at the high secondary, at the plus two stage. And it was felt that up to the 10th, the students should go through compulsory general education. And from the 11th, the alternatives were given. Various courses were offered, and we are very happy to note that some of these courses have now become the first choice courses of the students. The example is catering and restaurant management. As you know, Goa is a tourism destination, and a large workforce was needed for the hospitality industry. And this course has filled in that void. And if you see now at present in Salsit and Bardis, those courses are running to twice the capacity. If the allotted strength is 20, the institution is invariably made to take in 40. And the department representative will tell you that there are demands for opening of more such courses. Now that's one. Then in the technical and computer, these courses have done a lot. And the Copcoid. Now about the dropout, definitely it has reduced dropout in the high secondary. If you see the statistics, almost every child who passes SSC, maybe 10% of them drop out. They continue in 11th and 12th in Goa. It's a very good sign for the state, because it has pushed in more students into higher education at 11th and 12th. And you can see the changes. You get a generation which is educated and also which is empowered with some skills. Now these courses at present are covering around 25% of the enrollment. Now that was the national target, that was the target set by the framers of vocational education policy. And Goa achieved it much faster than any other state. In fact, this has not been highlighted. it's not been highlighted in the state. But when we go to the national forum, they are surprised that Goa has managed to divert so many students into the vocational stream. Recently, in November, I was in Patna, and they asked me, how do the students take it? Don't they think that it is inferior? How do the parents take? Then I had to explain to them that in the institution where I was, that is the Narayan Ashram, we had science and vocational, three courses, only technical. And the vocational courses would get full initially, much before the science. Of course, now the case is different, but initially it was like that. The vocational courses would be full before the science even. So it has got some stature. The parents also don't have a problem, at least the middle class parents. Maybe the others, they might have a stigma attached to the vocational courses. But definitely we have reduced the dropout rate. We have provided alternatives to the children. And Goa is one state where vertical mobility is given to the vocational students. Though in some courses it is not in the same street, but they can definitely go for higher education. Now, our plans are, as Mr. Timley has said, we want to go to the lower levels. Because for vocational programs to succeed, the dignity of labor, dignity of working with your hands has to be established at a lower level, right from the school. So our plans are, as per the RTE, child has to be learning or getting elementary education up to the eighth. So we don't interfere with it. They will get the normal education which is given by the RTE, under the RTE norms, the right to education norms. But when they join the Goa board, that's in the ninth, we want to create more alternatives. The scene is that once child passes eighth, many of the schools feel, okay, they are a burden towards the weaker students in the ninth. They will fail in the board exam. And sometimes many schools, though well-intentioned, maybe those intentions, the intention might be good, they will fail a student or detain a student. And that student is declared as a failure and sometimes drops out of school. But that is because of the fear of failure in the 10th. And they want to get high results. Now, one way to reduce the dropout rate would be introduce vocational courses so that children who cannot deal with the academic load can take vocational courses and get up to their 10th. So if we have reduced the dropouts in the 11th and 12th, we can reduce them still more in the 9th and the 10th by introducing vocational courses. The two areas we will take up immediately would be agriculture and the tourism, or you would say the hospitality. Because Goa, primarily the economy is based on tourism, and they feel that agriculture can be used to boost the tourism sector. So those will be the two areas which will be taken up next year. We are in the process of framing the curriculum for these two. And we will be taking up some other technical courses also. There is a institution called Pandit Sunil Lal Sharma Central Institute of Vocational Education, which is a wing of the NCERT, which will help us in developing the curriculum. And then we will offer it to the students. It could be, we work out the modalities. It could be either in the pre-vocational sector, that means they could drop some general stream subjects and take this, or there is something called work education that is given for every child in the 8th, 9th and 10th. So we could slot in these courses in the as one of the subjects under work education. So it will be the choice of the child and the institution whether they take it as a pre-vocational, well, take these courses as pre-vocational courses in lieu of the regular subjects like languages, maths, physics, science, maths and social sciences, or they take it in, as a subject of work education. So with this, I end but definitely saying that we can reduce the dropout rate, solving unemployment. My intention is that we have to create attitudes, and that once we create attitudes, certain attitudes in our students, which I think Mr. Kostabir will be able to highlight better, once we create them, we could take our students towards self-employment and other areas where the problem of unemployment could be reduced considerably.
Professor Rebello has, dealt mainly with the vocational education at the stage of at the plus 2 stage, 10 plus 2. And on the dropout, he is quite confident that the dropout rate has come down after the 10th standard as the students enter the higher secondary stage. He says this on the basis of the 25% enrollment that we have got of vocational stream in Goa. The examples that he has given of vocational courses, largely which are employable, are catering and hospitality and computer courses. Now, the plan for the future, as far as the board is concerned, is to introduce vocational component from the 9th standard. And the point that is made for that is that children who cannot deal with academic load. So, I'll have my own comments when I summarize, not at this stage. Because the conceptualization itself in our mind of education is, those who do not have the academic load, they should get non-load courses. And vocational courses are courses which give no load on the student. And that is why the student becomes unemployable. So it has got a direct relation to unemployment, whether vocational education has helped us to make people employable and reduce the unemployment. So if our courses are no load courses, then definitely they will not be employable. So vocational courses are actually skill courses, and they are job oriented courses vis-a-vis general education courses. So maybe that is an area which we'll have to work when we design the vocational courses and when we design the methodology of imparting vocational courses, and the student really feels that they are heavily loaded courses, and then we'll achieve the objective of employment probably. This is not the stage of giving comments, but these are a few observations or points that Professor Rebello has made. Now I will call upon Rose D'Souza, Assistant Director of Education.
Respected Chairperson, Sir Prabhakar Tinde, dignitaries on the days of the days, I'm here to present to you vocational education in the state of Goa. The National Policy of Education, 1986, stated that 25% of the student population should be trained in vocational trades. Accordingly, the state of Goa adopted vocational education at the plus 2 stage from the academic year 1988-89. This was done to prepare the students as an alternative to higher education in order to reduce the dropout rates. The main objectives of vocational education in the state of Goa was to prepare the students for areas of self-employment or wage employment, train students in skills to enable them to be employed correctly, enjoy the jobs where they are employed in, to reduce the mismatch between demand of labor and supply, and to provide an alternative to those intending to pursue a higher education. Highlights of the vocational courses in the state of Goa are divided into four major groups or categories: technical based courses, commercial based courses, commerce based courses, home science courses, and agro based courses. The students are free to decide which courses they opt for according to their aptitude. The intake of students are as commerce-based students. Course for a commerce-based course to run, we need a minimum of 20 students. And for a technical-based course, agro-based course, and home science course, we need a minimum of 15 students. The maximum can go up to 30 students. The courses offered under technical based courses are computer techniques. At present in the state of Goa, we have around 11 to 12 high secondary schools. MIRIDA, which is maintenance and repairs of electronic and electrical domestic appliances. We have 12 high secondary schools. Electronic technology, we have 7 high secondary schools. And auto engineering technology, 10 high secondary schools. Commerce based course, we have OSS, 19 high secondary schools. Accountancy and auditing, 9 high secondary schools. Marketing, salesmanship and management, 1 high secondary school. Insurance, 4 high secondary schools. Tourism and travel techniques, 2 high secondary schools. Management, industrial management, 1 high secondary school in the state of Goa. Then we go to the home science based course, and this is the first course, catering and restaurant management. We have 10 high secondary schools, and from our records we are very sure that 100% students after completing this course are employed or they proceed higher. Bakery and confectionery, 3 high secondary schools. Commercial, garment designing and making, this is mainly for girls. We have 17 high secondary schools. Then we have healthcare assistant, which is the need of the hour, because you must have noticed that in the state of Goa, we have the aging population, and the aging population needs healthcare assistants, not nurses. And we get them from Kerala and other states. Now we are training our students to be healthcare assistants, and therefore we have started this course, which is doing really well in 3 high secondaries of Goa. Agriculture based course, we have 2 high secondaries who have taken horticulture. Students offering vocational courses are given on the job training. The purpose of on the job training is to facilitate them from a world of learning to the world of work. So to prepare them for the job, for jobs, we have 36 working hours for the 11th standard students and 36 working hours for the 12th standard students. It is the duty or the responsibility of the head of the institution to place their students in appropriate industries, in appropriate institution, so that they get the correct on-the-job training. On-the-job training focuses on 4 basic areas, and the areas are punctuality, work ethics, which is very, very important, attitude, right thinking, and skills. The apprentice for the vocational stream. All the vocational courses in Goa are covered under the Apprentice Act of India 1961. This is very important to note. It was last amended in 2011. The features are as follows. All the vocational pass outs are covered under the Act. The Act specifies training for 1 year. No examinations are held after the training program. A certificate of 1 year experience is given to the students, which is recognized by all government and non-government organizations. The apprentice is paid a stipend of 1,970 per month. 50% is paid by board. Board is the Board of Apprentice Training. For Goa, it is the Western Region, Mumbai. After completing 3 years of in-service, the board pays the student 50% of the stipend. Now, most of the students who complete 1 year training are usually employed by the company they work with, because they go with an open mind and open heart to learn and to develop skills. So if they are right, they get permanent jobs. The courses are designed as per the nomenclature of the Act. Okay? Pre-vocational course, as sir has spoken, Sari Bello, is a very important thing for us now, because many students drop out from schools because they cannot cope with certain subjects like mathematics, science, social studies. So now under the pre-vocational course, they have an option to opt for a vocational course in place of a core language or the core subjects like mathematics, science and social science. So a student who cannot just cope with mathematics, instead of dropping out from school, he can opt for a vocational course and he can go upward mobility into a same vocational course for the 11th and 12th standard. pre-vocational courses offered are grouped as follows. Home science. We have cookery, which is very well taken by many schools, and we have 8 schools in Goa presently offering cookery in place of math, science or any core subject. Government cutting and sewing, we have 1 school and this is mostly taken by girls. Then we have government designing and decoration, 1 school, high school, and food processing, we have 6 high schools. Under the agricultural group, we have horticulture, floriculture, mushroom cultivation, vegetable cultivation. Horticulture, we have 3 high schools. The rest of the courses, the schools haven't yet opted for. Electrical group, we have domestic wiring, domestic electrical appliances, electronics, we have 1 school. So we have 3 groups under pre-vocational. Vocational students reduced, we can say that because of the introduction of vocational courses, the dropouts in the state of Goa have reduced drastically. Because now, as the SSC results were very good, we had many students coming in for admissions to the vocational courses. As a Department of Education, we have requests from many schools to permit them to increase the division for many vocational courses. Travel and tourism also is one course which is picking up now. Then CRM, catering, restaurant management. These are the courses which students opt for because they know that there are a lot of openings to the school and they will be placed well in life. Thank you.
Very short summary of what Roj Iswara said. At higher secondary level, in Goa, we have got 17 vocational courses.
At higher secondary level, we have 17 vocational courses. Technical based 5, commerce based 6, home science based 4, and agriculture based 2. So that's 17 courses at higher secondary level. And the component is on the job training and operation workout. I would call it operation workout, workout for the students. Except maybe there is a doubt whether the commerce-based courses, there is a reasonable operation workout. And that's the reason why we find mostly those who do vocational commerce-based courses, they would normally go for higher education immediately and they will grumble they are not getting admissions in institutions for their graduate programs. Maybe there's a vertical mobility is there because they enter the general discipline. So this operation workout on the job training, maybe we'll have to look more into how to intensify it as far as the commerce based courses are concerned. This is just a gut feeling. It's left for you to react. At the school level, pre-vocational courses, 11 pre-vocational courses, though it has been introduced by only very few schools. Home science based courses 4, agriculture based 4, electrical based 3. So this is a short summary of what Rose D'Souza presented. Now we'll go to the experience from the industry and the views of our Plesh Kostabir. He is an industrialist. Apart from that, he is a public interested citizen, lot of taking interest in public causes. He has been associated with maybe, I think right now we are IDC. He is associated even now with the IDC, Industrial Development Corporation, and other government bodies. So he can give us the picture or the viewpoint from the industry and also his views on the what vocational education, what changes we require. Mr. Blaise Kostabir.
Who is the most famous or liked US president? Can give you a clue, he also is the only one where he has a full-size statue of himself. Abraham Lincoln. Now this was a question put by a teacher to a kid who has just come in because he has technically failed the 9th standard and he is now going in for open school. Kid is, and all the 25 I think who asked the question were forlorn and dejected. And he asked, so why are you so sad? This guy failed 12 times and he became the president of the United States. So you are not a failure. It's only a stepping stone to success, you know, and all the kids brightened up or whatever. But I think that this was the raison d'etre of vocational education. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Unfortunately, I don't think it has been implemented in that way. And when I say I don't think, I'm not just talking as, you know, I have a business and I look at students who come for interviews. But I was actively associated with education. I was the chairman of the Chamber's Education Committee for many years, I think about 7 years. And I've interacted with the ITIs. I've been with the Pharmacy College. We started an institute managing committee there. The university trying to train the courses. We did train the trainer programs for teachers. And in this way, I think that I have some background with education. And on the other side, I'm also a parent, going through the same pulls and pushes that happened today. So, with all that, I think that views can be expressed, and there are also some solutions. Should we wait or just continue?
Continue.
So, the first thing I would like to bring out is when we talk about vocational courses, unfortunately, we put them into the bracket of failures. That means you take a vocational course, my friend, you are not good enough, you are a failure. That's the first thing we've ingrained into them. If you go to Germany, everybody does a vocational course, compulsory. And the chairperson was just telling me, but isn't medical a vocation? Isn't business a vocation? So we are all going into vocations, but we don't call them vocational courses. But in Germany, they all go through the same vocational course. They call it vocational course. So I ask you, if you have a guy who's a welder, he cannot do math, so he failed. He becomes a welder. But you look at him, he's a welder. Why don't you take the welding torch and try to weld? You can't do it. But that's his skill. But we look down on him. Why? Because I can add 2 plus 2. And so I think I'm superior. So, I also had incidents when you say employability. Most of the vocation courses, all the people are employed because, you know, they have, if you take farmers, they have a banking subject which is funded by ICICI Bank, and therefore the bank needs people. So they get it. I had a nephew who had to get into, he missed Xavier's because he was late or something like that. And they had a first come, first serve with this huge pass out that they had this time. So the vice principal was a friend of mine, said, why don't you take vocational? But my nephew says, you know who goes for vocational? Well, I didn't know who goes for vocational, but this is the way, you know, the attitude is, we have created the wrong attitude for this vocational. We have created it. And since this is also involving media, the media should ask themselves, who created this? In the last few days, you open any newspaper, the supplement they have, the Young Buzz, whatever it is, you have all the toppers featuring there. 96% musician, and you know, everybody. Any of the vocational kids who did well. One of the aims of the vocational course is that those who don't want to go to higher studies. But the department is proud that people after finishing are going for higher studies. Something wrong there? Statistics is a way of telling lies. Now we are very happy, I'm not saying anything about blaming you or something, but 25% are going for vocational. So we have met the norms and all. But they are asking, what does that 25% consist of? Why is it 25%? Is there 50% more that can come? Have we filtered them out in standard 10? The rule says that in standard 10, pre-vocational, which school offers it? My own son, and that's how I'm more connected this year with the stream, couldn't pass Hindi, so he has to stay back. And I say, even if he spends another year in standard 9, he is not going to go from 30 to 33, or maybe he will reach 33, what's the point? You're supposed to offer okay. So if a guy, somebody may be in maths, I think 28 who came back in that school. They don't have maths. He needs maths. The principal of Xavier's, who is now a chancellor in some one of the Allahabad University or something, says, I don't have any clue about maths, but I need to know is I gave the Bajewala $10, I bought Bajewala 8, I got my 2 back. That's the extent of the maths I need to know in my life. So we really don't need to have it. You can do something else. So we look at the courses. Now they say one of the problems with offering pre-vocational is that workload. So the teacher, how do you offer 5 kids or 28 kids different subjects? We have the NIOS, National Institute of Open School, which has these things. And I doubt, or I don't agree with what was said just now that vocational courses are no load. They have a different load, a different way of loading it. You go to the NIOS books, beautifully written, such lovely print, and you check with our own Goa Board books, which are crap. Actually, you can't even think of opening the book. It's so boring. I mean, today's age, day and age where we have, you know, multimedia. When a kid opens a book, you think he wants to look at it? You look at the NIOS books, but they're heavy. There are lots of chapters in it. Lots of things to do. You can't just think that you're doing open school, so you are going to pass through. I think if you're doing it that way, you are mistaken. So why can't the Goa board tie up with the NIOS and say, okay, these kids cannot do it, let them register and clear this subject and you add the 2, so there's no workload. That would be one of my suggestions, that you use a synergy. Today, industry does it. We don't do everything. You say, okay, you do something better, you do it for me. I'll buy it from you and I'll use it. Why should I develop all the facility to do that? So if you have a problem with workload, to give pre-vocational, which is part of your rules, and you conveniently forgot about it, and you don't mention it, and the government also knows that there's a low workload, so they don't take it quiet about it, they can use this facility. They can do it. But unfortunately, as you see today, the department representative is missing. Can you see him? One of the people missing is a vocational. He was from the vocational department, right? She is missing.
No,
you should be. Sorry. But he should be speaking, he should be up there. I mean, he should be frightened.
He wants to work. Those who don't work speak. They want to work.
No, I don't think that's. You should tell the department's point of view so that people understand and they can also say. Yeah, the education department, I have been vocational. But I had this problem, even the direct power, we were saying industry was trying to help him. He refused. Because of planning, now you're doing this April starting and all. For the same reason, you don't have the ability which is done in industry to plan. So okay, help us to plan. But it's something that we have to do. Maybe one of the other things that we could, when you say unemployment, it's not that all the vocational are employed or all the others are not employed. Everybody has a chance at it. No one asks. I don't think the industry asks, well, you've done commerce vocational, so we don't want you. Or you've done commerce regular, so we don't want you, we want vocational. So it's an attitude that is developed. In the list of attitudes that they develop in OJ under on-the-job training, I don't think how far you'll go with 36 hours. But isn't that something? 36 days. What about the others? That means those who are going through regular, who know their maths, who can do Hindi, don't need these attributes? Is the regular school not requiring the same attributes that they said that vocational students have to build? Punctuality, and you know, there were 4 of them, right? Work ethics, attitude, skills. Is not required by others? Or it's only required by those who are dropouts or failures? They need to develop this skill because they are not working hard enough and not passing in maths. So I think we need to look at this, that even our regular school needs to develop these attitudes. And that's what industry is looking for. Ultimately, all those, that's why we started the Train the Trainer program. We wanted the faculty who have been teaching for donkey's years and have never seen the changes to come out to industry, see the changes, and go back and explain to them. You know, tell them these are the changes I'm giving. For example, one simple example which you give all the time is, you take the job of helper. In the old days, you used to have a helper for every activity. If I am a machine operator, I had a helper to clear my scrap, I had a helper to lift it, I had a helper to pass it. Today, you can't afford a helper. So there's no concept of helper. You have to do them, and of course the machines have also become more user friendly, so it becomes easier to check. So if the people in the education field come over and spend 36 days, that's one of the month's holiday or whatever they have, interacting in the industry, then when they go back, they can transfer these attitudes to the students. But I think it doesn't work that way. There's too much of load and it's not working. Another thing is, bad sales hides bad products. I mean, good sales had bad products. It's a maxim in industry. So we heard now that there's a huge demand for vocational courses. So it's going well. I think the department needs to introspect. Why are they coming there? First of all, you had a huge amount of pass outs and they have nowhere to go. And two, can they get into science because they got only 70% when the closing was at 92 and at 78, and you know, everything went up. So obviously you have nowhere to go. So I think you need to look at those numbers. Maybe you can't do anything about it, but you study those numbers and say, why did they go? Maybe ask the students, why did you come here? Did you love vocational? That's why you came here? Or you just happened to come there? I think we should ask these questions so we can plan for the next batch that is coming out. And you would see that there was no planning even for this batch. All of a sudden, there's a huge demand because it passed out. And one theory is that this is the first batch that came out under the RTE, no fail policy. So there was a need to show that it works. And therefore you had a huge coming out. So I think you need to introspect and look at that aspect. Why they came in there. If they really came, fine. There's another thing that certain institutes in certain areas have certain courses. So let's say, Madam, give me one of the courses you said you have, electronics order, just say the name.
Maintenance and repairs.
Maintenance and repairs of household articles, right? Yes. Now you have that course in, let's say, a college in Sourdough. And every year you pass out 30 of them from there. Where are they going to get jobs? Because mostly from Sourdough only they come there, right? You won't get somebody from Mapsa coming for this course. So you are creating one type of people in one area, day in and day out. What if you took this program one time in Sourdough, one time in Mapsa, and exchanged the program? So you had a mix and people are changing. You know, different people can go to the different courses. Is it possible or is it not possible? So you have to look at it, because otherwise you always have guys repairing home appliances coming from one area, and then what will they do? There were no jobs for them. They can't all get work in the same area. So I think that also has to be looked at. My last suggestion is media. I think since you are present here, you need to look at changing this concept that vocational is dropouts or failures. Vocational should be for any kid, even if he gets high marks, to go into an area where he prefers to go to do it. Ultimately, we are all here for a vocation. We have to look at it, and so the media must look at putting stories in of these students who are doing well, who were considered dropouts but are shining. Once that comes in, then maybe there will be a sea change of attitude, because we need to change the attitudes related or connected with vocational education. I think once we do that, then it will be different. It should be on par with the regular courses. It's not different, it is ultimately getting a job. I missed one point, and that is the Apprentice Act. As an industrialist, I am fed up with this act. It says that you know, it was built at a time when there were no jobs. So you had a Goa shipyard which under the Apprentice Act would take 16 people at a ridiculous salary of 1,900. Who will work for 1,900 today? You know what we do when we get someone who's willing to sign that Apprentice Act form? We say, okay boss, take 1,900. I'm not going to apply for 800 back, but the remaining 7,000 I'll pay you on the side. But just come under that, because otherwise that fellow from Bombay will come and say you have not employed somebody under Apprentice Act, so you will be faced with some legal penalties and all. He will even ask for money to bypass it. And he told him, Charlie, you bring the person and give it to me. Who will work? Which engineer or diploma will come for 1,900? It's a ridiculous act made at a time when it was required, when there were no jobs. So people were forced, like they go ship and take 50 people. And today, when there are so many jobs, people can choose, when the call centers are offering 14,000 and 15,000, which kid will come for 1,900? And he has to sign a bond, and he will sign a document that says, he will not leave my company for 1 year. He can leave. But the very fact that he has to sign it, he says, I don't want to do it. So what kind of an act is? And it should be looked at, but it, you know, there's a whole system that is being funded by this act. There are people whose lives depend on it. You take it away, they'll be unemployed. Start to think, you know, we need to look at this act, and maybe the government has to look at it seriously. And one test is, would you send your kids under this Apprentice Act to any company? So if you say no, I don't think it's a good act. I wouldn't send my kids, and if they have a choice, they will not go on their own. So I think that summarizes my thing. If there are any questions, or we can expand later, it's possible. So I would think that maybe the government should have synergy with NIOS to have this pre-vocational, as you call it. You take the load, you exchange courses from one place to another so that things are not all in one area. You repeal this, or attempt to repeal this absolutely, if I can use the word, stupid act, which is outdated. And the last but not the least is the media must play a big role in changing the attitudes of the people towards vocational courses. Thank you.
I was listening to Blaise Costepeil. I'm tempted to come to a generalization, which may be totally wrong also. But a generalization, and that is our education is now murdered vocational education by naming it as vocational. Because education, if it is connected to do things and to perform, you know, that's not education. Because it is not mainstream education. And those who perform and those who do jobs, it is not learning. Learning is something different than that. And probably that's the reason why people are not going for skills, because we have convinced the people that education means something other than acquiring skills. That is vocation. Just I'm making a statement for you to react later on. And that's the reason for these complexes. You know, a vocational student, तो हो गया भूगो वोकेशनल नहीं रहे मैं आता कोई दिन में एडमिशन आया लात को एडमिशन थी मैं ना मतलब वोकेशनल स्ट्रीम कर रहे हैं तो हो गया भूगो तो वोकेशनल नहीं रहे राइट मींस वोकेशन इज इन इंफीरियरिटी कॉम्प्लेक्स एंड गोइंग टू यू नो ए नॉन वोकेशनल ब्रांच इज सुपीरियरिटी कॉम्प्लेक्स व्हिच वी हैव क्रिएटेड एज एजुकेशनिस्ट दैट्स द पॉइंट आई वांट टू मेक. The next is a very operationally very effective suggestion which Blaise Costepeil has made is when we are going for vocational courses, of course the issue will be of how to get teachers. That's one. And what will happen to surplus teachers if students take vocational courses? That's point number two. Because anyway, our education is teacher based rather than student based. I always say everything is fine with education as long as the Department of Education releases the salary grant in time. The moment there is a one day's delay, that means the government is playing havoc with education. That's our mentality. So the point that he has made is, this is a very relevant point, that courses which are introduced should be loaded. They should have difficulty level. Vocational courses actually are not easy. Unless we water them down and make them nothing. Suppose a course is introduced in tailoring and embroidery. Take it, Shikobasa. கரகடி பொறுக்கி சிக்கல கரகடி மண்டு எம்பிராய்டரி மண்டு. So we do not know that embroidery and tailoring has got a big market. So we just water it down. Salesmanship and publicity mil lagide ethe beshte theche. So we only water it down. Te mashi classes shikla puro ekte man mela puro. So we have watered down the vocational courses. Agriculture. Now everybody feels agriculture madhe kay shikopana mhanaka. Ata decide kela. हेडमास्टरांनी डिसाइड केला, टीचर्सांनी डिसाइड केला, पेरेंट्सांनी डिसाइड केला, भुरग्यांनी डिसाइड केला. ते हॉर्टिकल्चर, ते एग्रीकल्चर आणि ते किते व्हॉट आर दोज कोर्सेस, दोज नेम्स आर देयर फ्लोरिकल्चर. ते आणखी शिकवायचे ते घराकडे टंगेले असं दिसतं मागे तसं जागो ते ती रोयतले आणि भुरग्यां कडे एक मागीर आम्ही जागोरा ती दोन दिन हे हाडून टाकतले गुलाबा झाडा घालते असे. सो वी डू या सो वी वॉटर डाऊन द वोकेशनल कोर्सेस. And the difficulty level has to be maintained, and that is why he has suggested that to take care of the course content and methodology of learning, you know, we can have tie-ups with, you know, there may be Shrama Vidyapeeth somewhere which run these courses, which have got course content, which has methodology. You know, tie-ups means not that we should go and take our training there and then we should teach them here. We can have a tie-up there. The students learn through a distance learning program, like with the NIOS, you said, no? And then that institute gives them the certificate. If that institute gives a certificate, then automatically this school here, or the Goa board here, whatever it is, can give them that particular grade in that mark list. So automatically you get that. So this is one suggestion that has come. The second thing is of, you know, amendments or abolishing the Apprenticeship Act. And the third important thing, since this is a media seminar, what they said is media should showcase vocational education and achievers in vocational education. So that would help, you know, to change the mindset. It may take another 10-15 years for us to change the mindset, because we have taken 50 years for this particular kind of mindset. With this a short summary of what the place was said, I throw it open for all of you.
In relation to the topic of dropouts, as an educationist, okay, we even teach our students this. The reason for people dropping out from school could be one of these three. One being, what they are learning in school is not relevant to their lives. I'm learning geography, I'm so poor, I'll never be able to travel to any of these places that I learn about. Why do I need to learn geography, for example? Okay, that's including interest and no relevance, okay? If I'm interested in something, I will learn it, whether or not you teach it to me. I will find the books, I will do anything, but I will learn it. If I'm interested in music, I will learn it. If you force me to learn something that I do not want to learn and I'm not interested in, you have to force. And many students here will also corroborate this fact. Okay, if I'm not interested in it, why should I learn it? Why should I learn maths? Why should I learn trigonometry? I'm never going to use it. Okay, some subjects are difficult. Like you said, maths is difficult. I myself found maths difficult. Science is difficult. Yes, but are they needed for everybody? Okay, there's this person who's come out with this theory of multiple intelligences, Howard Gardner. Okay, it's a very well-known theory, it's a very recent theory, and he talks about how everybody is not intelligent in language, everybody is not intelligent in maths. There are people who are very intelligent in a athletic way, in a musical way, in a naturalistic way, meaning with plants, with environmental issues. Is there anything in our schools today that gives them an opportunity to not learn maths and science and do something that is related to their field of intelligence? Because for that you don't even need to teach them much, okay? Then there's this concept of homeschooling, okay? Homeschooling. There are parents in Goa who school their children at home, because I was taught in schools today. Trust me, the teachers don't teach anything much. They're either correcting books, reading from textbooks, okay? Or they're talking some boring information which the students are not even interested in listening to. I mean, how many of us would sit and listen to a 2-hour lecture and everyone is going on talking? Teachers don't even use innovative methods to teach. So how do you expect students to learn and grasp, okay? In fact, one of our Gandhiji, Okay, very famous person Gandhiji. He himself said, textbooks are not for students. Textbooks are for teachers, so that they know that the information they are giving to the students is accurate. We are here giving the textbook to the student, telling them read, marking the answers. This is the question. This is what you should answer in relation to that. There is only one right answer, and you will solve this math problem the way I teach it to you. If you solve it any way of common sense and the answer is correct, you don't get your marks in between. Any 10-sided student will tell you that. You don't see all the steps, you don't get the marks. Okay, so if you are facilitating an education system like this, okay, then obviously there's going to be dropout, there's going to be failure. Then who wants to listen to the fact you're failing, failing, failing? Arey, better I go out of the system. Okay, so it centers around many things. So these concepts that he said on National Open School, everyone thinks it's for duffers. Okay, but like I said, the portion in that is much difficult than the one that a 12-sided student is doing. So we think that it's for duffers, but the people who pass out through that have to go through much more rigorous thing. And it also offers you the option of choosing your subjects based on your interests. And it is also open to people who have never gone to school. For example, if say I am not putting my child in school till the 7th standard, in the 7th standard I realize, oh, let me put my child in school. Will the government offer me the chance to put the child in school? In the 9th standard, can I take my child? Anyway, you are passing them till the 8th standard, so can I put my child in the 9th standard? You will ask me for school leaving certificate, have they passed the exams of the previous year, this, that, so what is the big deal? Anyway, you are passing them till the 8th standard. So there are a couple of issues that I was thinking you could address in this. I mean, do you all answer all these questions? I mean,
as far as the Goa board is concerned, this is for your information. You can answer your SSC without any schooling background as a private candidate. There is a scheme for private candidates. The only thing at present which keeps you from answering is you have to be 17 years of age as on the day you answer, and 19 for 12th standard. So the scheme is there. You need not go to school to answer a Goa board exam, but you have to be 17 years and you have to register yourself at the board as a private candidate. In the June of the year, you will be answering the exam, previous June. So it is available, you can check it on our website. It's there in the rules of the Goa board. So we have a system where, but the regular subjects will have to be offered. That's the only thing. So coming back to vocationalization, as we said, we have plans and also there are subjects available, but many of the schools are not offering them. They are not allowing the children to take those subjects, pre-vocational subjects. We can drop some subjects. Of course, we want to fine-tune. We want to allow the student to drop more than one subject. At present, it's only one subject that is allowed to be dropped. We want to change it. Maybe from next year, we'll modify that. And again, you will be allowed to take those subjects if you can arrange for some instruction and assessment. That is the only thing, because there is internal assessment that is to be done when you're answering through a school. So if the school can arrange for internal assessment, they can allow their children to offer subjects which are not offered in their school. It is very much. And we are going to fine-tune it this year. Possibly next year there will be an array of subjects that we will place before the schools. They can take those subjects and allow them to be offered. Again, coming to NIOS, I don't know whether they'll be able to give you skill-based subjects. We're talking here about vocational subjects. And skill-based subjects will be given only when there's a laboratory around or you have interaction with someone who's skilled. NIOS will give you computer-based subjects and knowledge-based subjects. They are testing on the IT platforms. Painting is there, yes, a few, but skill based, what we talk of, the technical subjects and all, Goa board is having them. We intend giving them to the students very soon. Next year, possibly, we'll start offering them. Because we are aware of all this thing, at least I am personally aware, and I come from a technical background, so it will be facilitated very soon.
Yeah. I'm Bharat Naik, Vice Principal of MBS Higher Secondary, Vocational Stream. I would like to supplement Ribeiro sir here. This year, one child from last 2 years, he was coming to our higher secondary for a pre-vocational course. A child who studied his 9th and 10th. Because electronics was not offered in his school, we took over and we said that we are going to offer him electronics. He has studied in our laboratories, he has studied theory in our classrooms, we have taught him specifically. And that child has successfully completed his SSC by dropping mathematics and taking electronics.
Yeah, the child came from regional.
The local people are feeling alienated, and therefore this whole issue of dropouts, has there been any study done on why these dropouts? I'm just raising it from the point of, if we see a large amount of suicides taking place, we immediately try to set up a suicide helpline. So rather than going into why these suicides are taking place. So similarly, the question is there any study been done on why these dropouts are so-called dropouts, and from where are they coming? The other point is, with so much migration taking place, I know lots of school students who are first-time learners in their families, class 4 employees, children. What are we doing to take care of a cultural background of a student who's come from Karnataka or some drought-prone area of Maharashtra, who is now studying here, or from Andhra Pradesh? Who is the student and who is the new goal? How have we factored these vocational studies? Because I am just looking at the courses that you have mentioned. And is your home science, this is for Rose, the home science which you mentioned, are you having any dialogue with the home science college on an annual basis or 6 monthly basis? Or are they providing any guidance, or the faculty, or is there any link? Because I see home science there, and there's a college of home science, and if there's no network between the two, so these are some, I mean, gaps which I am trying to.
Would you term a dropout? A student who leaves a formal education is like.
No, I'm asking who.
Okay, for example, if a student of standard 8 is finding a particular subject difficult, and mostly in our study it is mathematics and science, so that student in the 9th standard would drop out at 8th standard. There was no option for a pre-vocational course at the 9th and 10th. So that is how we...
Is it fair to say drop out? I opted out.
Opted out means, see, what happens when a school, when a student leaves a formal school, because they find certain subjects difficult. They are facing the situation in our government schools and many other schools. Their students, they leave schools only because they cannot deal or cope with a certain subject.
Why I'm saying, whether when we are in the age of being gender sensitive and all this terminology we are using, how in the education system we are continuing to use the word dropouts, and this entire vocational submission which we have made. I'm not saying
dropouts, we mean they're leaving school.
No, please. I'm not saying this is your submission, I'm raising it from a larger perspective into the house here.
Okay.
Because if you look at the number of suicides taking place of young kids, if this is one of the points that you don't fit in, so might as well kill yourself. 13-year-old boys and girls are killing themselves in
home. See, Roland, there could be many reasons why.
No, I'm not saying.
No, correct. You mean he is not expecting a response from you or any
of the. I'm raising it to the house.
Yeah, that's correct.
To the house.
Yes, please. But there is a study done. Roland, Father Roman has done a study, and he even presented it to the regional plan, the draft regional plan, where he has looked at the number of students reaching 10. Who start and how many reach 10th, how many go to 12th, and the number progressively comes down. So from 8th, the number to 10th will be lesser. From 10 to 12, it will even be more. And from 12 to graduation, it's, so he's asking where those students have gone. That was his question. But the details, more details, I don't know, but maybe you can check with Father Roland, and he has done, Roman, and he has done this study.
To get more, avenues of how to do it, just go through on the website Indira Gandhi National Open University. One, they have a lot of certificate programs. Let me first complete for upgradation of the skills, and their programs are very good. Their instructional materials are also are very good. That's one. Second thing is, you can also go through the Yashwantrao Chavan Mukt Vidyapit. They may have these programs, I am not sure, but these people have, our Indira Gandhi National Open University have, something related to what you have said.
Okay, now the second problem we had was this program was done through SSI. So the certification is not from the education department, the certification was from SSI.
That's okay. We are not discussing issues of certification here. I don't know why you are asking that question. In terms of recognition or something like
yeah.
No, to do the IGNU program, you don't require certification.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's just fine.
Yeah. So, I just want to make an observation. Yesterday, we had.
No, I think I gave you a chance. Anybody else? No, oh no. Please don't mind. You spoke, yeah. That the future is always better than the past. Think over again. Yeah, yeah, it's always better than the past. The present is always better than the past. No, I'm not making fun of you. Because as the present situation is always better than the past, and the future will be better than the present because technology changes, information changes, avenues of information changes. Think more about it. Think more about it. Anyway, can I summarize now? I'll just take 5 minutes to summarize. Yeah. But you wanted to say something, otherwise you'll shout at me while having lunch. Let me just summarize. The first point is I want to take you on a different trip for 2 minutes. We are talking of vocational education, dropouts and unemployment. That was the issue before us. Let me remind you that in this area, lot of contribution is there of the non-formal, unrecognized, unorganized educational sector in vocational education. We should not forget it because we are only concentrating on Goa Board, Goa University, Department of Education. Now, I take you back to courses like typing and shorthand. Who started them? The unorganized sector. Now they are not required, but that served the needs of the society of those times, you know. Now you feel, what is this stupid thing that you are talking about? I am starting from there. Courses in refrigeration, courses in air conditioning, front office management, ticketing, radio and TV mechanic, tailoring, culinary skills, catering, handicrafts, photography, art, music, secretarial practice, you know. All these are vocational courses, which we now are bringing under the formal stream. But they are also conducted very effectively and very efficiently by the unrecognized sector. And then they may be charging high fees, but students, equal number of students are also going there. If in our higher secondaries, we have maybe, let's suppose 3,500 to 4,000 students opening vocational, how much? More or less. Okay, 6,000 students are opting for vocational courses in higher secondary, maybe equal number are doing the vocational courses in unrecognized and unorganized sector. And so many institutes are there. So that's one point I want to make. The second is a summary of what we have been discussing. And I would like to summarize it by again going to a generalization. The generalization is like this, something like this. See, you know, you said that let's think beyond. So I am thinking further beyond. And further beyond is why, because the whole issue of vocational education is in terms of showcasing it. So should we showcase it as skill and productivity education rather than vocational education? So we have to come with a new phase, because vocational again would mean it is for the weak, it is for the dropouts, it is for those who are not so good in academics, because academics is education. And the other thing is not so much education, it is not a main, it is not a highway, it is a by lane. So can we make this by-lane into a highway? So instead of speaking about vocational education, can Goa plan for skill and productivity education? That's how I start. See, skills are present in all communities. Because no development can take place without skills and skilled people. So if Goa has developed up to now, it is because of skills that were present in the society, which were a result of formal education, informal education, illiteracy and no education. Do you follow what I say? I hope you understand what I am saying. I am just putting before you a picture. Because we removed the skills from our formal education system and we said, shikap milari hai, tu karta hai shikap nahi. So we have to upgrade our skills into education, and for that I come to 3 points. One, what we need is technology upgradation in skills. This is the work of universities, research institutes, laboratories and the government. technology upgradation in the skills, whether it is fisheries, whether it is agriculture or horticulture or music or whatever it is. We need digital technology, repairs and maintenance of electrical and electronic equipment, whatever it is. So we need technological upgradation in skills. Second thing is we need academic status in the form of curriculum and certification to give glamour to these skills. Sheti hi pari mhanle mhanun glamour hadpa jay. Glamour fakt taka academic status aile reta. So to these skills we have to convert it into curriculum and certification. And that is the job of boards and universities. That is academic inputs plus skill inputs equals a curriculum. So Jaina, no questions now, please. You only listen now for some time. Be patient. So what I'm saying is academic skills plus inputs plus skills. I'm not using the word vocational. Plus productivity skills equals the curriculum. So now our curriculum is devoid of productivity skills. It is having only academic inputs. So like, you know, we say, you know, person has productivity skills, but he doesn't know about government schemes. That is an academic input. He doesn't know how to communicate. That is an academic input. He doesn't know how to organize himself. That's an academic input. So if we can convert our present vocational courses into skill courses with academic input, with certification, it gets a glamour. And the last aspect is marketing infrastructure. And the area for agencies in this area to work is government, corporates, corporations, cooperatives, informal unions. And we need an interlinking of all these three. That is the universities, boards, and government, and cooperatives and informal unions for the success of skill and productivity education. So I would like to, you know, wind up by saying vocational education can be converted into skill and productivity education, and can all these agencies work for improving the productivity of the learners through changes in technology, through designing of curriculum, and through providing the marketing support at a later stage. Marketing doesn't mean trading. See, now corporations that we have got, they are not doing marketing, they are doing trading. And with all these, whatever skills we have got, I'm not, because we call them traditional because we are not using technology, whether that can be a base for the what we intend to do as the vocational education for the future. So with these observations, I think I will take it as closed.